The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Ancient civilizations are remembered for a variety of reasons. Egypt for her pyramids, the grandeur that was Rome, the glory that was Greece. But how about our own civilization? Sometimes in my darker moments, I wonder if perhaps ours won't be remembered as the creators of the sleeping pill, the little pellets that have brought surcease from care to so many, and, unfortunately, death to so many others.
All this he needs is a good cameraman, and we could make a film.
Please, Jenny, control your sense of humor. And here, take this pill.
I never take pills.
It is just to help you through the final rite, the making of the mark of the Walpurgis Club. That way, I promise, you won't even feel the heat of the branding iron.
Our mystery drama, Woman from Hell, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Murray Burnett and stars Joan Lovejoy. It is sponsored in part by the Florida Orange Growers and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Suicides always rate a few lines of newsprint. But every newspaper headlined the shocking and totally unexpected death of the legendary superstar Jennifer Grinnell from an overdose of sleeping pills. The question on everyone's mind was, had this fantastic woman taken her own life? In Los Angeles, the medical examiner's office was off limits to reporters seeking the answer. One man, however, had been admitted, given a report, and now he walks slowly down the long corridor out of the building and into the bright California sunshine.
Mr. Ducot! Mr. Ducot!
I have nothing to add to what I've already said.
You've got me wrong. I'm not a reporter. Here's my card.
Durrell Jones, private investigator. I have no need for a private detective.
But I need you. You see, someone's hired me to look into this death.
Then I'm not the only one who feels there's something very strange about this so-called suicide?
You can say my client has some doubts.
And who's your client?
Oh, come on, Mr. Ducot. You know that information must be confidential.
Good day, Mr. Jones.
No, wait a minute. Where are you going?
To my car. It's in the parking lot.
Okay, if that's the way you want to play it. Have you ever thought how much better your chances are of proving your wife didn't commit suicide if you had some professional help?
That was my introduction to Mr. Durrell Jones. Other introductions are in order. My name is Lawrence Ducot, the man who accompanied Jennifer Grinnell through life, her only husband, but a husband who remained so discreetly in the background throughout her flamboyant career that only her intimates knew she was married. Nevertheless, I loved her, and I could not allow the world to believe she'd taken the coward's way out. And so I found myself in a quiet restaurant, drinking coffee with Durrell Jones.
I'd like to know why you're so sure that Jennifer Grinnell didn't commit suicide.
I should know. I was married to her. We lived apart, but we kept in touch.
Oh, give it up, Ducot. You're never going to make anyone believe you and Grinnell had a close relationship.
I was under the impression you were going to be of some help, but you're just the same as the police. I don't know why you bothered to ask me to talk.
Because I'm getting paid to do a job, and you've made a lot of waves by going around insisting she never would have killed herself.
I'm no expert, but don't most suicides leave a note?
Not all of them, but more do than don't.
There was no note.
A point. But not conclusive.
Do you believe in extrasensory perception?
Now, there's something that would look great in my report. No hard evidence, but husband says that his ESP tells him Grinnell was murdered.
How about a tape recording?
You have a tape proving she was murdered?
No, not exactly, but if you want to come out to my house, I think you'll find it interesting.
Okay, where's the tape?
Let me explain. I can't afford servants, so I had this telephone answering tape installed. And since Jenny and I spoke frequently, I've kept a tape recording of every phone call.
Very clear.
10 days ago, I called her. Here's the call. Here are her words.
Hello?
It's me, Jenny.
Oh, Larry. I'm so glad you called.
You're in trouble, aren't you?
Yes.
Money?
Worse.
Can I help?
I was just writing a letter to you.
You can tell me about it.
Oh, no. No, not over the phone.
You're frightened. Now, what is it, Jenny?
The one secret I ever kept from you, my pet.
Well, tell me.
The letter I have just written to you, it should explain enough. Goodbye, love. You were so sweet to call.
Jenny, don't hang up. Jenny. Now that you've heard that conversation, what do you think?
I can understand why the police weren't interested.
You don't believe that she was frightened?
Sure. But of what? She didn't mention anything specific. If the police and the medical examiner say that Grinnell killed herself, I'm not about to argue with them.
Well, then, why did you take the case?
That's the way I earn my living. A client asks me to look into something, I look into it. That's why I'm here. But I'm not on anybody's side, and I don't like to make myself look like a fool, especially in front of the cops.
I see.
Now, she said something about a letter she was writing you. Did you ever get it?
No, she must have had second thoughts after she talked to me. I never received the letter. It was a lie. I had received the letter, but I felt that it would have been useless to show him. His mind seemed to be made up, and so was mine. Jenny had said one secret she never told me. Because I felt that Jenny's secret lay in her past, I went to the man with whom she'd had her longest and closest relationship, the spectacularly successful novelist, Bruce Brown. He was working at his latest retreat, a remotely situated house on the Greek island of Samos.
You're here about our girl. How can I help?
Well, first by telling me whether you think she committed suicide.
Hell no. That's why I hired a private detective.
By the name of Durrell Jones?
That's my boy. Has he been in touch?
Yes, he has.
And?
He thinks she did it. Whew. Does that make you change your mind?
Well, it bothers me. Jones is good. Who would want Jenny dead?
Bruce, she was scared.
Scared? Our Jenny scared?
Our Jenny.
Hey, look, do I catch a whiff of jealousy after all these years?
Come on, shall we stick to the subject?
Right after I tell you something.
If you don't mind, Bruce, I think I...
It'll only take a minute. Now, you know when I first met Jenny, and you know how I fell for her. But what you don't know is that I proposed to her. You know what she said?
Not only what she said, but how she said it.
She told you?
She didn't have to. I know the routine. She opened those violet eyes wide and in her best ingenue voice said, "But I am married."
Yeah, well, what you don't know is that I asked her to get a divorce. She refused.
Welcome to the club.
You say she was scared. What was scaring her?
I received this letter, postmarked the day of her death. Shall I read it to you?
No, no. Yeah, let me.
Dear heart, there is no way you will make any sense out of this letter. But I do not see any other way. If 1 week after you receive this craziness, I am still alive, you will destroy it and forget it. If something should happen to me, then you will make your own decision. Yes, I am afraid. Of what? Of a mistake I made back in the days of innocence. I never told you, but now it has come back to haunt me. But I also have another secret. I kept a diary.
A diary? Jenny, a diary like any schoolgirl. I don't believe that. She's putting you on.
Now finish the letter and then we'll talk.
I have written both too much and not enough. But for your own dear sake, I warn you, trust no one. No one. Adieu, Jenny.
Well, what do you think?
I think if this letter had been written by anyone but Jenny, I'd say it was a woman who was going insane. But with Jenny, well, there's no question she was scared. And fear, Well, fear is just the wrong emotion to associate with Jenny.
If we think that way, we're not going to get anywhere.
But what do we want to get?
I want to get whoever killed her.
You think we can?
She has the answer in her diary.
You know where it is?
I have an idea.
Excuse me a moment. Yeah?
Bruce, this is Jones.
Yes, Jones. You got something on the Grinnell case?
Look, I'm calling to tell you that there is no case. The dame took an overdose of sleeping pills, period. There wouldn't have been any talk at all if it weren't for her husband. He made news just by turning up. Very few people knew that she was still married to him.
Well, did you talk to him?
Oh, sure. I even listened to a tape of a phone conversation he had with her, but that just proved she was upset.
Larry, did you show Jones the letter?
No.
Hello? Hello, you still there, Bruce?
Yes, I'm still here.
Oh, look, I haven't got a single clue that points anywhere except to suicide.
Okay, you've made your report. I want you to stay on the case.
For how long?
Until I tell you to quit, or until you tell me you're quitting.
Okay. You're paying a hell of a price for what I think is plenty of nothing.
I understand. You keep pitching, and I'll keep the money coming. Bye. Glad you heard, Larry.
Yeah, I heard.
He's convinced it's suicide.
I'm glad you didn't tell him about Jenny's note.
But I didn't because you didn't, and come to think of it, why didn't you?
Because Jenny specifically wrote for me not to trust anyone.
But you've already disregarded that bit of advice by telling me.
What Bruce Brown said was true. But I hadn't told him everything. I hadn't told him that Jenny's favorite song was La Vie en Rose, or that I felt Jenny was trying to tell me something about the diary and how to locate it. That's why I stood on the cobblestones outside René Pergamot's florist shop on the Rue Clichy just 2 days after I talked with Brown. René's window, with its usual bounteous and beautiful display, brought back memories. And as I stood there, René himself came rushing out.
Monsieur Ducot, monsieur, may I express my condolences and shock at this sad news? When I heard, I could not believe.
I know, René, thank you.
Come inside. You're most welcome, mon ami, and expected.
Expected.
But of course. A few days ago, this little package arrived from Madame, addressed to you and marked, hold for arrival.
There are people who have actually died from fright. Medical testimony bears that out. The question in our tale seems to be, can fear actually drive a person to take his own life? A logical answer would be, some people. But would a woman like Jennifer Grinnell be driven to this act of desperation? We'll be back with the answer right after these messages. Now, what does anyone expect to find in a florist shop in Paris in the spring? Fresh cut flowers, certainly. The lovely scent of burgeoning spring plants and, of course, the undertones of romance which accompany the annual springtime awakening of the City of Light. But for Lawrence Ducot, the florist shop of René Pergamot might hold the answer to a riddle, the proof that his glamorous wife did not take her own life.
How long are you staying in Paris, Monsieur Ducot?
Well, that depends, René, on what is in this package.
Monsieur, let me assure you, if there is any way I can be of help.
Well, that's very fine of you, René.
Let me get the door for you. These are not just words. Attention, monsieur, watch out!
Well, let him go, René. But I won't forget that I'm even further in your debt. You know, he really might have hit me.
It was almost as if he were trying. That is our Parisian drivers for you.
Hop in, Ducot, quick. Jones, what are you... Come on, or we're going to lose that car that almost got you.
You know, you're talking like a man who believes that car really tried to run me over. It's a lot easier to believe that than your story that your wife didn't kill herself. Still, why would anyone want to rub you out?
Because, perhaps, of this package.
Ah, damn. You lost him. Now, what's such a big deal about that package? It's my wife's diary, complete up until the day of her death. Do you intend to follow me wherever I go from now on?
I think you need protection, Ducot.
Maybe, but I can't afford your fee.
Don't let the fee worry you. I'm already being paid.
Oh, a room service, please.
Is your client paying for this, too?
Of course. Oh, yes, two special lunches, the fillet of sole and a carafe of white wine to 731, Mr. Ducot's room. Thank you.
If you've really got your hands on her diary, it might change a lot of things, but somehow I never thought of Grinnell as the type would keep a diary.
For once, we're in agreement, but...
Here it is. Do you recognize her writing?
I'll take your word for it. But before you start to read it, think. No one, not even you, suspected she kept a diary. Maybe there are some things she didn't want anyone, I mean anyone, to know.
Jones, you're a fool. I was married to Jennifer Grinnell for 23 years, and I knew her a lot better than anyone guessed. We're not going to find anything in this diary she'd be ashamed of. The years fell away, and memories came flooding back as I read the entries and found myself again under the spell she'd always cast for me. I could see her sitting in the small, cramped flat we'd had in Paris right after our marriage. I could smell her perfume and hear her as she wrote in the diary I never suspected she kept.
And such foolishness today. Mutzi, my agent who adores me, has made an appointment for me with Anton Krasuski for the lead in Woman from Hell. I told Larry, thinking we would laugh. But he thinks I should go. I told him I would. But I refuse to make a fool of myself.
Jenny! Jenny, are you home?
Larry! I will give you only one guess what we have for dinner.
Did you go to see...
But a small clue. It is heaven.
Well, what about Krasuski? Did you like him? What did he say?
Oh, he said I was a fat cow who would be fine as a milkmaid, but to play the lead in a picture as big as Woman from Hell...
Oh, you're lying.
Of course. I did not go. It would have only been a great waste of time.
Yes?
May I speak with Jennifer Grinnell?
Who's calling?
Anton. Who is it?
Krasuski.
You're a waste of time, Anton Krasuski.
Now, young lady, you will tell me why you failed to keep an appointment with Anton Krasuski yesterday.
May I have a light, please?
Do you want the part?
Are you offering it to me?
Here is your light. The part can be yours, depending.
Depending?
On how much you really want it.
Why do you choose me, an unknown actress dreaming of a career, for the lead in the most important film of the year?
Because I have seen your nightclub act. Because your insolence and your beauty are perfect for the part.
Well, pardon me for being slow, but I thought there were other considerations.
Only one. Join the Walpurgis Club.
The Walpurgis Club. And what is that? A club of witches?
Exactly.
It was a desolate house in the country, lit only by firelight and candles, with weird music, and people drunk, not with liquor, but with some kind of frenzied belief in the magical power of the devil. As Krasuski took me through the various rooms, he watched, and then asked perceptively...
You find this amusing?
That disappoints you?
Not at all. But I must warn you that this is literally playing with fire.
With hellfire?
A most exact description. And now I would like you to see the altar.
The altar is impressive. But I was more impressed with the worshippers. They believed. And people who believe as deeply as they did can be dangerous. Krasuski was most cordial today when I again visited his office.
It is my belief that you were born a witch. I only wish to reawaken your slumbering destiny, as I'm sure I can make the hidden fire in your eyes burst into flame with the proper caresses.
No doubt. But just what plans do you have for me in the Walpurgis Club, if I should join?
You will be a star, believe me. The club has helped me in my career, and I know we can help you.
I will do as I always have, help myself. What I was asking was, what does the club expect of me?
Only to recruit members.
And suppose I should fail?
You fail? Unthinkable. But we are not monsters. As long as you sign the membership papers and are bound by our rules, you will find us most agreeable.
You know enough about me to know that I like to make my own rules.
Not in this game, Sherry. Not in this game. Ever.
How can I tell Larry the truth? He smugly keeps reminding me that he was right about me getting the part in Woman from Hell. How I ache to tell him about the Walpurgis Club. But I cannot. And even if I did, he would just laugh and dismiss it as a silly joke on Krasuski's part. I must admit, I felt the same, but there are certain things that worry me. As, for example, today, when we were rehearsing privately the scene where I show Carrie the tortures he will suffer in hell if he allows me to seduce him.
No, 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 it is all wrong.
And how many men have you seduced, Anton?
You will listen to me, because when this man takes you in his arms, he is doomed for all time. If you do not believe, how do you expect the audience to believe?
This is your picture.
And you are the woman I chose. A woman from hell would know. She would see immediately that this is a man who likes to suffer, who enjoys being tortured, so that he will have the best of both worlds, you in this and eternal punishment in the next. You know this and you are amused.
I am not confused. Tell me, Anton, how do you know all this?
Don't you know? I have a hotline directly to hell.
I do not like it. I do not like it at all. But I cannot withdraw now, and the picture promises to be a success. It is almost frightening, the knowledgeability that Anton shows about the workings of hell. I even accused him of it the other day during a break on the set.
But why should you question my knowledge of witchcraft and diabolism? You and I belong to the same club. I am reaping the benefits of years of research.
And your payment, Anton, for these benefits. How much is it, and when is it due?
I will tell you. Or perhaps you will know when the picture is finished.
I loathe fidgety men. And Anton has become extraordinarily fidgety. He has also become a bore about other men. He blames everything upon Hollywood and the Klieglit frenetic quality of our success. But this is nonsense, and he knows it.
When are you seeing him again?
You mean Bruce?
You are forgetting an obligation to the club to which we both belong.
I cannot help it if I am not a good saleswoman.
Isn't that an understatement? Your record is immaculate. Not one convert to the Walpurgis Club since you became a member.
Remember, I warned you about the possibility of my failing.
I remember. And now it is I who have to warn you. Either Bruce Brown becomes a member, or you will suffer severe consequences.
They overestimate my influence on Bruce.
They know just how infatuated with you Bruce is, and you have never really believed, have you, Jenny? And you won't until it is too late. However, we have a problem.
We? Do you mean you, the club, or me?
All of us. You remember Jacqueline Fournier?
Of course.
Then you may also remember that she was announced for the part that I gave you in Woman from Hell.
Must we go through this ancient history?
I am afraid we must. You see, she has heard rumors about the Walpurgis Club. And she threatens to do a whole expose, claiming you got the part through witchcraft.
Let her.
The club does not think that would be wise.
Then let the club stop her.
That is just what they intend to do. Fournier can be appeased. With your influence, you could get her a part in a picture and she would be happy.
I do not pay blackmail.
I told them what your answer would be. But, Jenny, for your own sake, get Bruce Brown to join the coven.
Hello?
Hello?
Have you seen tonight's paper?
No.
I thought you should know that Jacqueline Fournier met with a tragic accident. Her car ran off Mulholland Drive and crashed. She died almost instantly, which, of course, is something to be thankful for.
Accidents can happen anytime, anywhere. And today, everyone knows what you mean when you designate a person as accident-prone. On the other hand, would we be so willing to say someone was accident-prone if we knew that a coven of modern witches wanted that person dead? That knowledge bothered even the strong-minded Jennifer Grinnell. I'll be back shortly with Act Three. One of the most famous and dramatic moments in the theater occurs in the play Peter Pan, when the actress playing that immortal boy turns to the audience and asks them to applaud if they believe in fairies. Invariably, the house breaks into a storm of applause. However, would the audience response be the same if the actress asked for applause from those who believe in witches? That was precisely the problem that faced Lawrence Duco as he tried to prove that his wife didn't commit suicide. Her diary asked him to believe in witchcraft.
Now, if you want to waste some more time, we'll continue reading the diary, but my advice would be for you to burn it.
Less than 2 hours ago, you were all enthused over the chances of finding the answer to Jenny's death, and now...
You're not thinking, chum. You started all this because you wanted to clear the stigma of suicide from your wife's name.
And I still do.
Even if you now brand her as a believer in witchcraft, a wheeler dealer in the occult who built her whole career upon a deal with a coven of modern witches?
I don't see that it has to be put just that way. And I'll make my decision when I've finished reading the whole diary. And so I reopened Jenny's diary, and again found myself reliving those days when Jennifer Grinnell was Hollywood's biggest star, and I, her husband, was a forgotten man, while her romance with America's favorite writer, Bruce Brown, headed the list of items in every gossip column.
Hello?
Jenny, it's me. I'll pick you up at the usual place at 9.
Oh, that is not possible, Bruce.
Why, what's up?
I thought we had gone beyond questions.
Well, I thought so, too, but that was before we stopped seeing each other. Or haven't we stopped seeing each other?
More questions?
I'll pick you up at 9.
No, not tonight, really.
Tomorrow?
I suppose I owe you that much, love.
You don't owe me a thing, and I'll explain when I see you tomorrow.
Tomorrow will be the last time I see Bruce. It is something I have refused to face for too long now. But I am afraid I believe that the Walpurgis Club is an evil and vicious thing. If they are not witches with supernatural powers, then they are criminals. Because I cannot believe that Fournier's car crash was an accident. And I will not even talk to Bruce about joining. Poor Anton. I must lie to him. Or maybe not. Maybe the truth would free him. Come in, Anton.
Isn't that your phone? I hear ringing.
Yes.
Why don't you answer it?
You know me better than to question me, Anton. I do what I choose. If I do not want to answer the phone, I do not.
Because you know very well that was Bruce Brown calling, and you did not want to talk to him.
So?
You have deliberately broken off your relationship with him.
And if I have?
If you have, you have done something I have never known you to do since we met. You have broken your word.
So I have. And it is about time you should find the courage to break yours also.
Don't talk to me of courage. You could continue to see Bruce Brown and never bring up the question that he's joining the club.
But that way you might get him into trouble if the club members are really witches and warlocks. So you take this coward's way out, and it ruins me.
What can they do to you?
For starters, they can take me off the picture.
I will not allow them to do that.
They have already done it. Will you answer the phone?
What do they expect to gain by punishing you?
First, discipline for the ranks. I was the one who recruited you, and that was an error. Two, they think perhaps out of a feeling for me, you will change your mind about trying to recruit Brown.
Ridiculous.
Yes, I know, but you will suffer too. Just wait until you see the new director.
At this point, I closed the diary. Jones looked at me inquiringly.
Had enough, Duco?
Now I understand what Anton Krasuski was trying to tell me.
You went to see him. When?
As soon as I heard he'd been taken off Jenny's picture and replaced by Luigi Ferrelli.
You seem to be pretty buddy-buddy with a lot of your wife's lovers.
Well, we had a lot in common. Would you like to hear what happened when I went to see Krasuski?
Well, I'm still on the case, and my report has to be written. Go ahead.
Of course, you never knew Krasuski, so you wouldn't have noticed, as I did, the changes as I approached his house. It used to be crowded and well-lit, and this night it was empty and almost deserted. I crossed the driveway, rapped on the door.
Laddie, come in. It is very nice of you to come and see me.
What happened? Why did they take you off the picture?
They said they wanted a director who would be less dazzled by Jenny.
Well, that's nonsense. Jenny's the star. You did two great pictures with her.
Nevertheless, they seemed to be logical when they chose Ferrelli. Do you know any director who is less dazzled by Jenny than Ferrelli?
He hates her.
And she him.
It almost seems as if someone wants to ruin Jenny and her career.
And me, no? Here. Look inside my forearm. Wait till I roll up the sleeve. Now, tell me what you see.
Are you sure you're all right?
Tell me what you see!
Well, a small scar. It's shaped like a horseshoe or a hoof.
That's right. Now ask Jenny. Ask her to show you hers.
And that's when I walked out on him.
Did you ask Jenny about her scar?
No, I never did. When she broke her leg and was taken off the picture, it completely slipped my mind. And then... Oh, well, you know what happened then.
Oh, everybody does. Your girl couldn't get herself arrested in Hollywood. She was finished in pictures.
You don't know what that meant.
Look, Duco, I am still interested in finding out what happened just before she died. And I think we ought to skip ahead in that diary and see if we can find out.
Yes, you're right. Now, let's see. Sometimes she dated entries and other times not, so... Oh, yes. Here. This one's dated just a month ago. And here's what she says.
It has happened. I suppose I should have known that someday it would happen. But I really thought I was finished with the Walpurgis Club. So many years had passed, and no word from them. And so it came as a surprise when I did hear, and in a way I never would have expected. My agent phoned and told me that Tyler Campbell wanted to see me. I'll confess, I felt some of the old excitement of meeting a talented motion picture director.
I've always been one of your greatest fans. Every scene in Woman from Hell is etched indelibly on my memory. I'll quote the dialogue for you if you like.
Would not you be embarrassed if I said please do?
If you want my company, all you have to do is pay for it. If you want my love, you will pay more. A price that I advise you no one can afford.
Enough, I am convinced.
I can't understand why a talent like yours shouldn't still be working.
Oh, I agree with you.
And that's why I've come to see you. How do you feel about trying a comeback in a film I'll direct? Of course, I wouldn't expect a commitment until you'd seen the script. You haven't even asked what the film will be about.
Well, I was not up to that in my mind.
Mm-hmm. It's about witchcraft.
Oh?
Does that turn you off?
Well, it is too soon to say.
You know I don't do ordinary films, Miss Grinnell.
Yes, I know.
And I assure you, the film is well worth doing. Today, witchcraft is in. but I intend to use it somewhat differently. I see you as fate, beautiful, enigmatic, and inescapable.
Interesting.
Good. I promise that I shall shoot you so that even in the cruelest close-up, your scar won't show.
My scar?
Don't tell me that that little mark inside your wrist is no longer there. Even plastic surgery won't eradicate it. And it's exactly the same as the one I have here, behind my ear. See?
Yes, I see. So this was all a trick. You are a member of the Walpurgis Club.
In good standing, Miss Quinnell. Which is more than I can say for you. But my offer to do a picture with you is very real.
I am not interested.
Too fast. You make a decision before you know any of the facts.
We have nothing more to
say. I suggest you listen. If you think you've paid your dues in full, you're mistaken. You betrayed us. And you betrayed your oath.
I am finished with you and with the club.
And you will be. I promise you. Do one small favor, and you'll be a big star again. And no strings attached.
How do you mean, no strings?
You will be allowed to resign from the Walpurgis Club. The only member in its 300-year history to be given that privilege.
I have already resigned. I have not been to a meeting
what
or...
What we have in mind does not necessitate your going to a meeting. You've heard of Jason Albright.
Who has not? He is the sixth or seventh richest man in the world.
Mm-hmm. Did you know that Jason Albright is one of your greatest fans?
No.
He's worshipped you for years.
How nice.
Jason Albright is very ill. In fact, he's terminal.
Well, that is too bad. My fan club will be reduced by one.
True enough. But you can make a dying man very happy. Simply by talking with him. Visiting. Spending a little time with him.
Are you out of your mind? Why would
I... Albright has no heirs. His will leaves all his money to various charities. But wills can be changed.
I see.
Of course. Simplicity itself. Nothing for you to do except spend a little time with Albright. Be your charming self and...
And persuade the old man that the Walpurgis Club is worthier than all of his other charities put together.
Precisely. Couldn't have put it better myself. Before you answer that, I have a feeling it will be Jason Albright.
What?
We managed to get word to him that you'd be receptive to a call.
I see. Hello. Who is this? No. No, this is not Miss Grenell. She is not at home. She will not be in for some time. No, I do not know. Goodbye.
That, Miss Grenell, was very foolish. I want you to think carefully. Think what a small thing we're asking of you. And then consider the alternative. We can make things very definitely unpleasant for you, Miss Grenell. Think it over.
How long do I have to think?
We can give you only 12 hours. And then we'll be here for your answer.
Alternative do I have? I cannot go to the police, and I will not have anything to do with the club or its scheme. So, I turn to my diary and write. And I get an inspiration. I cannot go to the police, but I can hire a private detective to protect me without telling him why I am hiring him. And I remember I had heard of a good one. I will call him this minute. There, I feel better. I have called and he is on his way. I hope he is intelligent. And that may be too much to ask. But his name is...
Hello?
Don't bother, Duco. I know my name.
You? You were the detective Jenny called.
I'll take that diary now. If you look closely at my wrist, you'll see the mark that her diary described so well. And now, of course, you understand why the cause of her death must remain a suicide.
Now, I know there are some scholars in the audience who will say that Walpurgisnacht, the witch's Sabbath night, named after St. Walpurgis, is a fake. And the Walpurgis Club, therefore, must also be phony, for the simple reason that St. Walpurgis was an English woman who never committed an evil deed in her life. I'll be back shortly with some more thoughts on witches and witchcraft. Witches and warlocks have been part of man's history and development since the beginning of time. And frightening demons and demonology abound in the history of civilization. And also in man's progress, scientists for years have solemnly announced that there are no demons, no witches. Then why do these myths persist? I think perhaps because we need them. If they really don't exist, then we'll invent them to answer this need. It's something to think about till next time. Our cast included Joan Lovejoy, Norman Rose, Mandel Kramer, Paul Hecht, and Nat Polan. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
How long does murder keep fresh?
Forever.
Even 20 years?
Whose murder?
He killed a priest.
A priest? Father Jim Morgan, what have you got?
What have you got?
You got my word that your sentence will be cut.
I made deals while you was in diapers. Now, we'll do it this way. My mouthpiece has to meet with a DA. And all the I's get dotted. And all the T's get crossed.
How do I know you got anything?
Only three guys know about something that could sit Mike Perry down in a chair. Mike, me, and Pop Morrison. I like you, copper. But first, my mouthpiece has to tell me we got a deal.
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and by the Florida Orange Growers. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.